in Western developed system tools. That's why I need it. What is optimal in Europe? Now I have to admit that my talk is very similar in structure to the FM. We didn't coordinate that much, but you will find in my talk first an introduction, kind of general point of view about optimal control, then dedicated work in function, and at the end project control. So maybe I bring in, like, in addition to the demo, I'm bringing Mario. Fun. The idea of the talk was to kind of give some general consideration about optimal control. And maybe my talk can be seen as a, since that was my intention, can be seen as a kind of a user feedback for the mathematician in the room about how roboticists are using their mathematical tools and maybe disturbing it and pushing it to its limits. So, I'm starting also by a simple example because I'm not sure that everybody in the room is so familiar with optimal control. So before starting with heavy maths, I'm giving some general definition. So we have this simple system that I'm taking as an example. So already for a simple system like that, you have a continuum of possible trajectories that you might consider. And we would like to discuss about these trajectories. And in particular, we would like to know what are the good trajectories, what are the bad trajectories, and among the possible good trajectories, pick one trajectory that you will send to the system to make it move. So an optimal control problem, before defining the optimal control problem, you have to define the dynamics of your system. So what are the motion capabilities? So it's defining a relation between the state X and the control U, and defining how the state will evolve when you pick a particular U. So for Mario, the state would be typically the position in the screen, and the U, the control, would be the joystick input. And the dynamics would tell you that when you are pushing the action button, Mario will jump. So already with the dynamics, some trajectory will not be good anymore. So for example, the yellow trajectory is Mario flying. This is not admissible for the dynamics, so you can remove it. In addition to the dynamics, you will put some generic constraints, or either constraints on specific state of the system. So for example, at the initial point, the system should be here, so the green trajectory is not valid. Or constraints on the any point of the trajectory, so like stay away from the monster that is here, so the red trajectory is not valid either. And at the end, when you sorted out all the bad trajectories, well, you still have generally an infinite number of trajectories, and then you will just score all the trajectories, and you can say, I will pick the one that has the best score. And for that, we put a cost function that is typically a cumulative term along the trajectories. So here, you want to pick as many coins as possible, and then the optimal trajectory will be the right. And the very nice idea of optimal control is that you will build this particular trajectory, the one that you want on the system, by doing choices that are mostly canonical. So typically the dynamic, it's canonical. That's the system you are modeling. There is no choice of the engineer here. It's just that you are representing what is happening on the real system. Same for the constraint. That's canonical choice. It's not really a choice of the system designer. For the cost, there is a choice. But the basic idea of optimal control is that this choice is not too complex. And you put something simple, and it will give you good trajectories. So for example, you put minimum time. Minimum time is a reasonable cost, and this will set you a good trajectory. And here enter the technical details. In robotics, what we can see is that, well, first, the cost function, as mentioned by the question of Christian, the cost function is not easy to choose. So typically, minimum time trajectory, that's a very basic cost. It's not producing nice behavior for the system. So typically, minimum time are saturating the system. So they are bang-bang, or they are going to the limit of the obstacles. They are not robust. So in addition to this, I don't know, canonical optimal term, you will start by putting regularization. And so for example, you say be minimum time, but be also minimum energy, and try to make a compromise between both. So this, I think, is a... Well, in machine learning, they say that regularization is the first sign of intelligence. So it's like, be smart. Don't be excessive in your move. Try to be minimum time, but if it's costing too much in terms of actuation, don't be so minimum. And already finding the good regularization is a big trick. Then you will add other terms. So typically terms that are representing some part of the dynamic that you don't want to model. So for example, if you want to obtain realistic move with a human avatar, but you don't want to model the musculoskeletal system, then maybe you can put minimum jerk in the cost. And minimum jerk will kind of represent the dynamics of the muscle, even if you don't model the dynamics. And you will keep adding other terms that are weird. So typically, if you are part of the dynamic that you are not able to model accurately or satisfactorily, like irregular constraints, maybe you can put that in the cost too, so that you are aware of this bad dynamic definition. And even you can put some terms that are guiding the search. So no terms that are interesting for your movement, but just because of the numerical algorithm that you are using to solve the problem, you put some terms to help you. So that's the first technical point. Second technical point is that to solve an optimal control problem, which is an infinite dimension numerical problem, you normally should go through indirect approaches like Pontryagin maximum principle or Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman principle. So this, I cover it by the general naming of dynamic programming. Sorry for the Russian team, Russian school. And well, this indirect principle will grant you when you are able to apply them, will grant you a complete resolution of your problem. But they are subject to the curse of dimensionality, and for realistic system in robotics, in most of the time we are not able to apply them. So for example, I have no idea if anybody trying to apply Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman for the walker problem, for the full humanoid walking. So as a roboticist, most of the time we go through what we call a direct approach, which is in fact we break the nice optimal control problem with a optimality guarantee into a static optimization problem. And so it's not anymore dynamic programming, it's differential dynamic programming. You take the tangent to the original problem and you work in the tangent. There everything is linear, so it's easy to solve. But then you don't have complete resolution, you only have local optimality. And most of the time, again, the standard problem that you get in exchange for your nice problem, it's a non-point problem. And then you don't have any guarantee anymore about the solution. And finally, even if we already don't know, if we already know that the optimum that we will get is only a local optimum, in general, we will even not go for this optimum. So here is a very nice movement that you get with HRP2 if you let the solver run for hours. And it's really a beautiful movement. You can see the swing of the arm to anticipate the swing of the leg, all this kind of stuff. But this is hours of computation. We want to have that as a real robot in real time, and then we only let the solver run for 100 milliseconds. And it's clearly not enough to discover a nice walk. And you can see here the optimality of this walk that you obtain in 100 milliseconds is clearly not as optimal as you want. Okay, so finally, we are not doing optimal control. We are just doing something that is, well, approximating a little bit optimal control. So why are we still continuing of applying that and calling that optimal control? Well, there is a bunch of reasons for which everybody or most large part of the robotics community is converging to applying massively optimal control in robotics for real robot. First, I think it's a very good way to select a good trajectory. Maybe not the optimal one. But in fact, we don't care so much about optimal trajectory. We just want the robot to walk, even if it's not the perfect way of walking. And in particular, it's much easier and much more generic to build a controller. So say, what we want, in fact, is a policy. It's defining this block that will, knowing the state of the system, produce. You can build that, for example, by and optimal control is a kind of implicit way of defining this policy, and we have automatic methods to go from this implicit relation to the explicit. And it's much easier, I think, to go with the optimal control relation than with the directly. Second, that's something that is not documented and not maybe formal the way that you try to express it. But I think that near optimality during the search is also avoiding jittering patterns. It's not a formal result, it's just in practice, so this is an example that I picked from Adrien Espron. Imagine a landscape function, simple function to two parameters, a starting point, and a typical search for the optimal would be something like that. So it's not a direct search, it's not perfect, but already it's continuous, or not continuous, but not jittery. Another analytical search would be this one. The point is that for model predictive control, we will apply partial results before going to the model. So the first point that we get, we will send it to the robot. And the third point, we will also send it to the robot. And if it's changing too much between two samples, it won't be acceptable as a control. So I think the first one, the one that is kind of continuous, that is acceptable for model predictive control, it's also coming from near optimality. If you are just selecting one trajectory above the continuum of possible admissible trajectory, you won't ever have such a kind of continuity. And last good consideration about optimal control in robotics. Well, finally, these problems of local optimality, non-convex problems, is very similar to everyday problem in numerical programming, generally in other fields, like in machine learning or in vision. And basically, locally convex programming is the technology that is currently working. So for an engineer, if you want to do something, that's it. And well, you have problems that you have to face with. You have to face them. And basically, when you are playing with a non-convex problem, there is two points that you have to pay attention to. So the development effort will be on two aspects. First, you will try to fight to have the problem as convex as possible. So change a little bit the formulation so that you obtain a convex problem, or a problem where the convex domain is as large as possible. And second, you have to try to initialize the search in the convex domain. I don't believe too much in the first direction. It's not that it's not interesting. It's just that it seems to me that it's, as an engineer at least, it's too difficult and not generic enough. Maybe you will find a convex formulation for the walker, but then if you want to go to another system like a quadcopter, you have to redo all the work, and this won't generalize. So I like very much the idea of giving the prior so that the system initializes properly. And maybe writing that as a very strong statement, what is interesting to me when I read a paper is not so much the particular algorithm of formulation that is used to solve the problem. It's rather the trick, the prior, the initial prior knowledge that is put to the system so that it's a properly warm start for the search. And looking at the presentation of Emo, you have, I don't know if that would work. No. Sorry, I tried to improvise something. So I wrote some trick priors coming from the talk of Emo. So first, he used soft contact modeling so that the search is interesting. Then he used periodic parametrization or triggering the move of the head forward to trigger a walk. Or in the contact invariant optimization, use an approximation of the discrete dynamics with a continuous dynamics, with a continuation to reach the optimality. And in learning, he don't learn from optimum directly. He's increasing the student's skills progressively with progressively harder solutions. And in the talk of Emo, it's not very interesting how is coded the particular. And this is not working anymore then. It was maybe too adventurous to switch application on the fly. So it's not so much interesting how we solve the problem. What is really interesting in terms of generalization capabilities for other researchers is all these tricks, all these kind of priors that are used so that the method is finally working. Okay, so I break my system. This is the fight against Microsoft against Apple. So Apple score first. And no input. That was a very, very bad move. Second point, second score of Apple. Yeah. Was a little bit too quick. I had the. So, I don't know. So, then I will have to load again the presentation, so sorry for that. So, well, what I was saying is that what is, I think, really interesting and is all the tricks that are used by roboticists, so form as a generic prior so that the non-convex search has a chance to work. Well, as you said, don't use the full screen. But I'm not sure that I will be able to have the videos. Maybe if you, somebody of my team could produce a laptop with Microsoft. I just send the link. I'm really sorry. So that's Microsoft win finally. So who will give? So that's Microsoft. And I don't have your team. I'm really sorry. Donne-moi ton adresse. Non. Maybe. Okay, so I think one of the prions that is used in robotics is typically this one. It's this division that is clearly unnatural between planning, control, and perception. In fact, this is one single problem. You have sensor input, and you want to produce it. And so you can see that as a big optimal control problem that you want to solve. But there is now no hope to have this complete problem solved in a generic situation. And then we break these blocks in several small blocks with some dedicated models and dedicated objectives, so that each block has a better chance to converge to a good option. And well, there is a lot of ways here in exhibiting priors. But typically, the planning will work with a static model, maybe a rough model, and give a rough motion to the controller. And then the controller will do an MPC, and because he has a good idea of what should be done, he has a big chance to converge to the So, now in the second part of the talk, what I would like to discuss okay, so I would like to discuss a way of coding priors for the specific problem of locomotion on any kind of theory. And we designed carefully a workflow so that at the end the optimal control has a chance to produce to be one started with smart movement. So in the first time, we will use a repeatability planner to find the rough movements through obstacles. Then, from this generic movement, so say, well, I want to go through the door, and I will take this general move. I will populate this rough movement with a sequence of contact. So this sequence of contact is not yet a trajectory, just a collection of key postures, each of them being static. Then we try to recover the dynamics of the full trajectory, but in the first time, not for the full whole body system, just for the central dynamics, because it's easier. And then when you have both the key postures and the central dynamics, then you will go for the complete trajectory and for the postural boundary. We are also working with perception, and I will just mention that because that's something that we are starting. If there is any feedback, So let's see first the first block, the activity planner. So basically, what we do here is a smart predictive model with heuristic, so that there is a big chance or a good chance that the rough path that we are finding is actually controllable by the model. And so the reachability test that we are building is, say, for the avatar here, we will represent this complex model by two simple models. First, a central block that should not be in collision. And the reachability region of the avatar that should be in collision. So if the central part is not in collision and the reachability is in collision, there is a big chance that we can find a posture of the robot that is stable. And that's a very efficient heuristic for two reasons. First, it's a fast decision making. There is only collision test to be done by the system, so that's really easy to do. And theoretically, it's built on a kind of sufficient or necessary property for contact creation. And you can adjust if you want to be more sufficient or more the necessary part of the property by one part of the picture. And well, it's a collision test, so then it will go through a random planner, so a probabilistic roadmap or rapidly scoring on trees. And depending on the environment, you will obtain the rough movement in about 0 to 1. Then you have the rough movement, and you want to populate it with contact. And there is a big combination here, because depending on what the contact that you are selecting at the initial position, the quantity you can advance while using this contact is difficult to quantify. And typically here, with the same initial position of the trunk, the sofa, if you choose bad contacts, you will not be able to stand up, while if you choose good contacts, you will be able to stand up. So we are using a second heuristic that we call effort, that is based on manipulability of the limbs in contact, so that we select good contact postures. And then we will use a pre-computed set of candidates, so from the initial gross form, we have a collection of candidate postures of the limb. We just keep the postures that are close to contact. We pick up the one that has the best score for the heuristic, and we collect it. And then the contact sequence is built sequentially, iteratively, so that we don't have combinatorial selection. So here there is a lot of reduction, approximation, heuristics, but the result is very good. We are able to find very complex movement in a really distant amount of time. So here, the avatar is about to escape from an accident in truck, so we block the door, the avatar has arrived, motivation to pass through the door. And it's a generic approach, so it will generalize to a spider. It will also generalize to HiQ, the quadruped robot from our Italian colleagues, walking on the debris, the DARPA. You see that for standard walking, there is no thinking. The planner finds directly something. When you have to go through the obstacle, it's a little bit more difficult, and he hesitates a little bit before finding the right contact. You can go to more complex situations. So once more, when you have something difficult to find, the planner will spend the time of thinking. When there is no difficulty, we just go through very easily, and you will find. So this is actually a very tricky movement, very close to the alpha benchmark of Jean-Paul, because in fact it's a long corridor in a high-dimensional space, so it's difficult to find. And the heuristics here are really tuned for locomotion, but actually they are also working for dexterous manipulation, so that's preliminary work. Obviously, some better heuristics should be tuned for manipulation, but well, we are able to find some stuff, so it's not too specific. Okay, so now we have the sequence of contact. Let's go to build another model now to find the dynamics of the central part of the system. So what we will use, so apparently the equations are not understood the same with an iPad or with a MacBook. So we will only consider the momentum of the system. So linear momentum, so the acceleration of the center of mass is equal to the sum of the forces applied to the system, and the variation of the angular momentum is equal to the sum of torques. So that's, and we also want that the forces applied to the environment are staying within the contact forces, within the contact cones. And well, typically, these models, if you combine it smartly, you will find a linear model, which is an inverted pendulum of Cajetan. Okay. Yeah, let's skip that because I can obviously not discuss this equation. So the idea is that we will produce a specific optimal control problem that is based on a more generic form, and the idea of this generic form was to try to cover all the pattern generators that was proposed in the literature. And when you have this general form of the optimal control problem, there is some terms that you are not able to express, and typically one term that we were not able to find a good way to express is what is the bound that you will put on the angular momentum. So we have no idea of what is the quantity of angular momentum that the system can have. So for example, here, when I'm like that, I can produce a lot of angular momentum variation. I can do that. And when I'm like that, I have no reserve of angular momentum, so I will have no possibility to produce a lot of angular momentum variation. And typically, when you are walking on a rope, you will walk like that, because you can vary a lot the quantity of angular momentum. So instead, because we are not able to find a good way of bounding that, we represent that by saying that the angular momentum at the beginning and at the end should be zero. That's for the final constraints asked by Christian. And we put a lot of terms in the cost functions, so that's a good illustration of the not so nice cost function that we are using. We have to penalize the linear momentum. We are putting a kinematics barrier because we are only considering the central dynamics, not the limbs, and we don't want the center of mass to go too far from the limbs, so we put some way of representing this part of the dynamics that we are not modeling. We try to limit the angular momentum variation so that we have a chance to say within these bounds that we are not able to express, and we try to penalize the forces. Well, and the contribution of that, apart from this specific form of the OCP that maybe is not so interesting, is that we reach real-time performance. So we have 80 milliseconds. It's a non-convex problem, so it's pure light that we have that, but it's working. Ready for doing. So you have the noise, sorry. An example of that. So the sequence of contact was generated by the contact planner, and then we find the central dynamics that is maintaining the system in balance. Well, and then the complete movement is obtained by simple inverse kinematics. And here is another example with HRP2 sounding up while using the wall. Once more, the contact planner is computing the contact sequence. The pattern generator is used for computing the central dynamics, and finally, an inverse kinematics is used. So here we use inverse kinematics. It's not satisfactory in practice. There is too much limitation. And the last part would take all these prions, and now the goal is to initialize Mujoko, so the work of Emo. So here is an example of Mujoko used on the real robots. So Emo started to show the movie. Thanks for stopping so that I can show it fully. So it's an example of multi-contact balance. We bring Mujoko in contact with the table because Mujoko is not able to find that the table will be needed by itself. The search is too quick. So there is not enough time for Mujoko to converge to something like that. But once we give the contact, the system is able to, in real time, generate the movement with the multi-contact balance. And here is a very important part. The movement is not so impressive. The very important part is that we have the whole body optimizer running in real time. Mujoko here is mostly open loop. It's running in real time, but it's only using the coder positions and even not so many of it. The idea is to have torque control on the robot with Mujoko, and we are facing technical problems on that. Here is a babysitter of the robot, so one of the two main babysitters of the robot in the team, trying to learn what is the actuation model so that we can have a good torque feedback. And you see that we are already able to do some very nice compliant movements. And well, maybe we'll have to change the robot to have the perfect solution. Okay, so that's basically feedback. It's trying to have a better model of the robot, but also a better perception of the sensor. The other approach is robust. So you want to compute to have Mujoko or to have the local optimal controller being able to be robust to sensor noise and to model problems. So typically here, if this is the polygon of support, for example, you don't want to put your center of mass too close to the boundary if there is some noise uncertainty in the model or in the perception. So basically, if we want to do that, as already said by Mo, well, there is basically two approaches that we tried. First, you can bound the error, and then you know which are the bounds that you have to put to your solution. Or you can also model the error as the random variables, and you then model the optimization problem with the probability constraints. So because you know that the tonks are your decision variable plus the random variable that you don't know, you want the tonk to be within the constraints with the probability higher than the So in fact, you can see that as a canonical way of defining the margin that you will have to put on the constraint of the system so that it's solution. And well, basically our contribution in this work is that the resolution cost of that is too high, so we figure out to approximate that in a way that it allows and here is an example of two examples. We put a lot of noise in the simulation, then the work is not so nice anymore. And you see that using a non-robust approach, the system will fall. Basically, we lose contact at some point, not able to activate the center of mass for one alpha second, and the center of mass diverge is not able to recover. While if it is robust, it's able to work with a satisfactory manner. Of course, here is just a random variable. So if you shoot another variable a second time, maybe this would work and not this one. So you have to do statistical tests. And in statistics, this is working better than this one. Okay, just one word about vision, perception. So in whole body force control, there is perception through force control and IMU that are very local sensors. We want to use also vision. And vision should be used for two purposes. First, for localizing the system around the environment that you know. And second, to model the environment. So that's SLAM, simultaneous localization mapping. The first one with a big L, you are interested by localization. And the second one with a big L. We already have some results. So this is a high dynamics movement tracking with a camera hold by hand with a IMU measurement unit, inertial measurement unit. And well, we are very happy with the bandwidth that we can get on the localization. So we are now porting that on the robot. And we are also interested in trying to extract some planar surface where the contact server can imagine. Okay, so we did that for locomotion. So we did a lot of tricks, heuristic, reduced model, maybe specific formulation of the optimal control for the locomotion problems. Now, we would like also to have that for quadcopters. So quadcopters is something like that. Should we do that again? So should we build again some heuristic reduced model? Because it took us maybe 10 years of research for a large part of the community to issue this reduced model. Here we can see that just using an off-the-shelf optimal control solver, we are able to produce very nice movements with complex dynamics. So this is an aerial manipulation. So it's a manipulation arm attached to a quadcopter, and we are able to do a force exertion on the environment. But it's not real time yet. It's not far from real time because the dynamics of the quadcopter is much simpler than the dynamics of the walker. And there is also some guide needed from an expert. So that's Mathieu that spent some time finding the good way of the initial guess, or formulating the initial guess for the system. And I don't want to spend again 10 years in finding this heuristics. So I think one of the very interesting problem is how can we generalize this heuristic automatically? Is it possible? So for that, it's very important to understand why a prion is needed in the optimal control search. Well, it's because the problem is non-convex, obviously. So here is an example, a simple example for a push recovery problem. So you have a system, humanoid system in balance, and you will push it, and it should recover the balance. And for push recovery, basically, there is two strategies. Or you can control the hip like that, and you will balance by maybe moving the upper body. Or you can step. If the push is gentle, obviously the step forward is less optimal. It's more consuming to step than to do hip balancing. But when the strength of the push increase, you will obtain something like that. So first, the this hip balancing minimum will become less optimum than the step forward, and at some point, when the push is strong enough, it will simply disappear. So there is no way of maintaining balance if you are just moving the upper body of the robot. And the optimal control will be very good when this minimum is still valid, because it's just tracking the previous solution. So it's an easy problem. It's very bad when this minimum disappears to find the second minimum that he does not know. So, and in the search, what you obtain is something like that. So this is the cost of the candidate solution that you are maintaining with respect to the iteration number of the solver. In the beginning, the solver decreases quickly the cost. But then you arrive to this flat region, for example, and that's basically first order random descent, so it's very slow, very inefficient, until finally it discovers the second local basin. And then it will converge again. So, and the time span in the flat region is really low. So here, that's where we need a wildcard. So we need something to say, well, hip balancing is not valid anymore, step. And then the life of the optimal control server is very easy. And basically, the heuristic and simplified models that I show are just saying that to the system, but in an uncrafted way. So we need to memorize that this solution is now the one that is valid. So let's represent that with a maybe conceptual way. You have a user defined task, and I think it's reasonable to say that it's very easy. Two days of work for skilled engineers to define the optimal control problem that is performing this task. And then, using Joko or something like an optimal control solver, with iterative optimization, we will find a movement that is suitable for the robot and a nice one. The problem is that this search is slow, so it's more something like that, slowly going to the robot. And it's too slow for any time, especially at some specific instance. But it's fine, the solver can find the movement. So since we can automatically generate the solution, we can also generate a lot of solutions offline. Because we don't care so much offline for the computation time. So it's possible to generate a solution to any to any situation that the robot can encounter. And then using this solution to any situation, well, we can one stop. So that would solve the problem. We have a nice OCP for online generation, and you just warm start with something you memorize. The problem is that doing some rough estimation for push recovery, this quantity of data would be something like 5 terabytes. It's not that much, but it's too much, clearly. So if you want to memorize all the range of movement of the robot, it's a lot of data to memorize somewhere. So writing the problem like that is just, in fact, reformulating the problem of motion generation as a problem of big data. You have a lot of data to store on the hard disk, and you have to find a smart way to compress this data so that they can use in real time. And the stake in data reduction is to find a structure, to exhibit a structure in the data set so that you can compress. And I think, well, that's a proposition, I would be very happy to discuss that. I think that the structure in the dataset, because it's a dataset of movements, the structure is exhibited by the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation. So we have to find a way of using AGB to express the structure and compress the dataset. So this is not far from saying we will reformulate the problem of data reduction as an inverse optimal control problem. And why inverse optimal control? Because to express a data set of movements, I think the best form is an optimal control problem. Well, typically, we have a policy stored on the hard disk. This is 500 terabytes. And we will find an OCP, a rough form of OCP that is less than 500. So expressing like that, we have an original optimal control problem that is hard to solve, but that we can use to generate a data set. And then we will search for an easy optimal control. Here, just to be sure, we are not looking for the original program of this data set, because we know that. This is very small. That's maybe, I don't know, 40 kilobytes. But it's too slow to decompress. Okay, going from here to here, it's too slow. So here we will make a trade-off, allowing for having a bigger data structure, but that is faster to generate. So we can see that data annotation problem as an unsupervised learning problem. We just find a way automatically to find the structure. So unsupervised learning is kind of known as not working. The technology is not mature. But I don't think it's an unsupervised learning. We can supervise it by simply the structure that we already exhibited for the control. So we can just redo the same structure, but by learning. And we know that there is a block of neurons that should extract a rough path. And then there is a block that should extract the dynamics of the central system. And why redoing that with the same structure? Maybe we are already at the structure that, so we can think there is no interest. But first, there is an interest in terms of generalization. Because we know that these models are valid for multi-contact locomotion. But they are not valid for dexterous manipulation. They are not good enough. Or they are not valid for coding, so for continuous contact. So that's the first point. And the second point is that these blocks yet are decoupled. Then that's heuristic, so it's suboptimal. And if we learn all that together, we can hope to have coupling and then to have optimality. Right now, there is a problem between these two blocks. What is the feedback that we will have is that Justin that is taking care of this block, we write a command to Steve that is taking care of this block saying, can you modify the temperature model so that it's not producing this problem? That's my last slide. I really think that such an approach can work. And there is several assets. Well, first, as I said, it's not supervised. It's supervised. We can supervise the compression by providing the structure. That's a big appeal that might make the system convert. Second, we don't care so much for the accuracy of the storage. The data that we want to recover won't be sent to the robot directly. They won't be sent to Mujoko. And Mujoko would take care of refining this sample so that it's fitting with the dynamics and the optimality of the robot. And I think the last asset that can be seen also as a problem. Our training data set is purely artificial. We are generating it. It's not like in a recognition for vision where we have to produce natural images to train the system. But then it means also that's complex. But I think that the current state of the art in robotics allows us to produce this data set automatically. And then the asset is that we can generate also new samples on demand for the system to learn. Okay. So that's the end of my talk. There is a lot of people working behind, so I put the biggest head that work on the system. And I would be very happy to discuss the content.
Any question for the break? Yes.
So, Nico, do you think it matters where the data came from, or do you think that anything that's remotely plausible, you fit some function approximator, and that's good enough?
First answer, I don't know. I was really interested by the work of you did with Igor, showing that you have to have some consistency in the training data set so that you won't confuse the learning system with some variability maybe due to the optimality. And that obviously showing that the data set that you are providing is important for the learning system. And that seems to be natural. You don't want to be the system to be from scratch very specific. You want to keep some generality. And then maybe can be seen also that we train the system with human data. And I don't believe so much in that. I don't know if it was the thought beyond your question. We could train the humanoid with human data, but the dynamics are not the same. I won't be confident. So I mean, the need of generalization for the learning system seems to be very high. And as you said, it's not generalization; it's just interpolation. So. No chance.
Okay, so maybe a little last question, and we are already late by 5 minutes. So, okay, let's see the speaker again.